the gift of a good night's sleep. So that's hard to quantify, and I feel like the only way to really know that you've got a good night's sleep is relating it to a really crappy night's sleep, mm-hmm. really bad night's sleep, right? But that's something that's changed. We're kind of talking about the, kind of my career or the time course of Advent is something that's changed massively in society is the recognition, the realization, the fact that sleep is cherished now versus not that many years ago, 5-10 years ago, it was sort of like, yeah, kind of, sort of, but now it's both within the medical community, but especially I think outside the medical community, sleep and a good night's sleep and how important that is more and more recognized.
I would say it's definitely, I agree with you. I think there's a better body of knowledge or just media talking about it and things, but I would challenge it in the sense that I think that people might be aware of it, but it still hasn't changed what they're doing day to day or what their daily grind is. Mm-hmm. You know, like they might know it's more important, but still I don't think people are necessarily accomplishing that yet.
Yeah, no, not that it's not happening yet for most folks. I'd say, talking about this country in particular, I think that there's sort of a lag time between when something's recognized as, oh, this is important, yep. and then what are you going to do about it? And then I feel there's also sometimes a recognition of this is important, and then a sort of drift away from that thought process. I'm thinking about like back in the old days, back in the 80s and 90s, how this whole no fat, low fat kind of craze
sure.
came in the mix, which was all about health and like, oh, you need to be healthy, you need to eat right, and marketing, and I think it's that's a really interesting story how like no fat, low fat actually is the thing that's hurt this country. Like if you want to look at the obesity epidemic, you track it from when right. people stopped eating fat and started eating carbs big time. And not that carbs are bad either. So now there's like this, oh, carbs are bad, you should never ever touch a carb. I'm just saying that sometimes the pathway towards good is leads you through some weird journeys until you kind of come back to that pathway. Mm-hmm. And I'd say the fundamental pathway, so from a sleep standpoint, I don't think anybody would argue that sleep is crucial, sleep is important. I mean, sleep is an important part of who we are, and you have to sleep to be functioning well. And then there's nuance around that. There's stuff that's like the low-fat stuff that's in the sleep thing between, all sorts of nuances that you could talk about. But one thing that nobody can argue with, and I challenge you, anybody out there, bring me some counter evidence to that, is if you cannot breathe properly, you can't sleep properly. If you're snoring or you have sleep apnea, that's your body crying for help. That's fundamental. Like there's nothing more fundamental to a good night's sleep than a adequate ability to breathe.
Yeah, and right? I think there's two factors in play there for patients. There is the long-term health risk, right? And then there's also the daily how you feel. And I think that what's challenging sometimes, or it's just kind of a journey you walk with patients when you're in the room with them, is that a lot of how, they've started here, and maybe they were great when they're 20, and now they're 40 or 50 or 60, and they're here. But the journey there took such small tweaks at a time that, like, you're here and you're really far away, but they don't notice the change, right? Mm-hmm. Because things gradually happen, right?
Right.
So then now you're here and you're like, well, what did it feel like to get a good night's sleep? And like, I think I'm okay, and right. I think I breathe okay. And so you're having this longer conversation with patients about, look, your nose should work well, it should feel really good, you should feel great when you wake up in the morning, ideally, mm-hmm. assuming there's other factors that play a role in sleep, but your breathing shouldn't be one of them, let's put it that way, mm-hmm. right? So you can feel like that again. What does it remember to feel? It's like hard to remember what it felt like. And so, patients, I always joke that like when you take the blue pill and you can never go back then again, right? So it's like, once your eyes are open again, like it's really hard to take steps backwards. And so maybe reset them.
Yeah.
But patients are pretty darn happy when they're starting to breathe better, feel the quality of life bump, know that their health risk is taken care of long term because their sleep apnea is treated. But like, I mean, let's put it this way. And when I've had patients in the room after doing a 15-minute or 20-minute procedure in the office, right? Get their sleep apnea controlled, that have said this has been life-changing for them. And my answer to them is typically like, I didn't do anything other than get your nose working again. And then we got your sleep apnea treated.
Sure.
Like it wasn't like we were doing this crazy 15-hour surgery, right? Like we are doing things that are simply getting their noses working like it should work.
Right.
That's
And for a lot of folks, it's never worked that way. And we do tend to diminish the impact of that to some extent because, you know, at the end of the day, you know, both you and I and every ENT surgeon, you know, at Advent has been trained to do exotic, convoluted, complex procedures. Breadth of our training.
Correct.
And yet, I think the challenge sometimes for us is the simplest, in ENT generally, is the simplest things that we do are the most impactful.
Yeah.
When you take somebody whose nose isn't working, which the nose is the start of the airway, you take somebody whose nose isn't working and you flip the switch there and you get it working, you've changed somebody's life.
And when we say working, it's you should be able to breathe well through your nose freely, day, night.
Mouth shut, nose open, day and night.
Right.
That's what you're supposed to. That's the toolbox. That's what you should have as a human being. Many folks don't have that. I would venture to say, really, you know, in talking to enough folks and seeing enough of folks as patients, is that I'd say most is a strong word, but it's shocking how many people don't have that.
Right.
And if you don't have that, you can't live the life you're supposed to live. You can't sleep the way you're supposed to live. You can't. There's been plenty of studies looking at this, both in humans and in primates and other animals, is you want to mess up somebody's sleep as you plug their nose. Simple. You know, the opposite is simple. You take a clothespin, you take a clip, you put it on somebody's nose, have them go to sleep, and somebody whose nose was working somewhat functionally, all of a sudden is going to have the worst night's sleep that they've had either in a long time or for forever. They'll wake up with headaches, they'll wake up with a dry mouth, they'll wake up feeling fatigued, they'll likely be sweating all night, they'll probably be grinding their teeth at night, they're going to be fighting. And what is all that? That's your body fighting to breathe.
Right.
Like, what's more fundamental is, you know, if and we say this often, but I don't think you can say it enough how important breathing is to every animal in the world, including human beings.
Right.
And so you want to, you know, set somebody up for a life that's less than it should be, that's worse than it should be, that's limited, is you start constricting somebody's airway. And, you know, again, you want to set off the most, you know, active fight or flight mechanism for somebody. You take a piece of steak and I'll throw it in your windpipe and you'll go through all sorts of contortions and motions, and even though you can't talk, you know, we'll get that thing out of there and make you feel better. But folks are doing that multiple times every single night. And because they're sort of kind of asleep, nobody's really recognizing how big of a problem it is. But you can't. If you dealt with that one time where you're trying to breathe and your throat shuts down and you can't breathe, it's going to be a memory that haunts you. So that's weird. So, meaning that it's not weird, it's true. Like, if I did that to you, you would never forget that. Yet, if that happens to somebody 100 times or more, a few hundred times every night, they forget it because it's just sort of their norm.
Right.
It doesn't make it not shocking. It means that the shocking thing, the thing that's like anti-life, is the thing that their body just somehow got used to, because bodies get used to a lot of things, unfortunately. Right.
And I would say to patients, don't underestimate the ability to feel better. And I mean that in the sense that people are afraid to ask the question often, and we talk about this a lot, but, you know, because people think that the only solution is a CPAP machine because that's what kind of the rest of the world tells them, essentially. And
right.
So people are afraid to ask the question. They feel like they can't get a hold of it because, like, hey, I'm not going to wear that CPAP machine. This is just going to be my life moving forward. But the reality is there are many options that are out there. We go through the gamut of them with patients. And you can do this study at your house. You know, and as we've talked about, we're kind of revamping and looking at how to bring the best technology to patients to be able to get that diagnostic sleep study in their own bed. And so that, again, you can ask the question, find out the answer, and then take control of what you're going to do there. You know, CPAP machine, sure, it's one option, but it's not the only one. There are other ways to get over the goal line that way and feel better, you know. And then when you're on the back end, you'll be like, well, why didn't I do this before?
Sure.
You know?
Yeah, and I think, generally speaking, not 100% of the time, but pretty darn close. If somebody comes in with a concern that something's not right, that something isn't likely right,
right.
You know, kind of a thing. Sometimes, I mean, rarely somebody will come in and everything looks just fine. We'll do a home sleep study. Everything's looking okay. And there are other reasons to have poor sleep other than just sleep apnea and snoring.
Right.
And sleep apnea and snoring coexist with other conditions often, like insomnia. So insomnia, just to kind of clarify, insomnia is where you have a hard time falling asleep or you wake up and wake up easily. That's a problem. Sleep apnea is when you're going to sleep, obstructive sleep apnea is you're going to sleep, you're trying to breathe and your throat is shutting down, which doesn't let you breathe. Now, lo and behold, there's a really high correlation. If you have untreated sleep apnea, it's very likely that that's going to create some degree of insomnia to some extent, because you're going to sleep, you're getting strangled, therefore your body doesn't want you to go to sleep, and once you do fall asleep, it wants to get you up immediately because it doesn't want to die. It's that kind of simple from a mindset standpoint. Is your body, its whole, sort of the first thing on the checkbox is, can I breathe? And if it can't breathe, everything else down that checklist, it's not that it doesn't matter, but it's going to be impacted by that because your body is going to be thinking about that first thing always.
But think about the way that so coexisting at the same time, insomnia, restless leg syndrome, sure. Obstructive sleep apnea, right? And think about what is the most common way to tackle those issues for most patients are, let me give you a sleeping pill to treat your insomnia.
Right.
Let me give you something like Neurontin or Gabapentin or some of these other medications to treat your restless leg syndrome. Hey, sleep apnea isn't being treated. You're never going to get a hold of these other issues. Sure. And the reality is if you get your sleep apnea treated, now maybe your insomnia improves or might go away.
Right.
Because now you're actually getting good sleep. So you're not getting ripped up out of sleep. And maybe your restless leg syndrome ain't an issue anymore because you're sleeping.
Correct.
Right. So, but if you think about outside of here, the way patients are treated elsewhere, like they'll just get a bunch of meds thrown at them and they'll be on their sleep pills and their trazodone and everything else to try and get to bed, and then still it doesn't matter because the quality of your sleep sucks.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, and we've said it before, but like in an emergency situation, EMTs, ERs, fire departments, they follow the ABCs. Airway is the A in the ABCs. Airway, breathing, circulation, in that order. It's not BAC, it's not C, it's ABC. And so, yeah, I would agree. Like, whether we're talking about somebody who's grinding their teeth, if we're talking about somebody who's got rest, there's some downstream issues that could be issues in their own right, but oftentimes are tied into an airway issue. And if it's all kind of bound together, how do you get it unwound? You start at the top. You start at the beginning, you get the airway fixed, and the nice thing is we can do that in a very simple and elegant manner typically these days. And then that's sort of that first, okay, get that thing righted, and then let's see what those other things have.
Right.
And oftentimes, shockingly enough, is oftentimes you get somebody's airway fixed and they're breathing properly, and oftentimes, lo and behold, wow, they're not clenching the jaw when they're sleeping at night. Well, imagine that.
They're not posturing forward. They're not having back pain and all that stuff.
All that stuff, which I think people, those things, so what you just said, which I'll, it's challenging for me sometimes because each of these things is massively impactful. So forward head posturing is normally when you're sitting, your chin should be back so that your head is sitting on your neck properly. Forward posturing is your jaw is moving forward. Why does your jaw move forward? Because you can't breathe. And so if your airway, when I move my chin back, that constricts your airway. If you've got a good airway, it doesn't matter. And therefore, you're in a good position. If your head's forward, or if you have a poor airway, then what you end up doing is your mouth falls open, possibly, or you lean forward a little bit. And so what ends up happening, you take this big bowling ball that's supposed to be sitting right on your neck, and you put it forward a little bit. What does that cause? It causes all the muscles in your neck to be under tension. It's a domino effect. Mm-hmm. And so there's a lot of people who have neck issues, who have TMJ issues, who have headache issues, have facial pain issues, that have airway issues. And yet, those downstream issues are the ones that get all the focus because, if your neck's sort of jacked up, you're not really necessarily thinking about your airway. But if you don't get the airway part corrected, all the other stuff is going to be sort of, you're wasting effort there.
Right.
And it doesn't mean, now could you have a perfectly functioning airway and have neck issues, TMJ issues, yeah, you could. But if you have both of those things, it makes sense, and it's the only right way to do it is to get the airway right at first. ABCs. Every day of the week is you know sort of how it ought to be. And as simple as that is, it doesn't really exist outside of our walls.
Right.
And again, it's part of our mission, part of our charge is making sure there's understanding awareness of these realities.
So, I mean, it may sound cliche, but, you know, the gift of breathing is the gift that keeps giving because sure. It can help all of these downstream effects for patients that are positive.
Yeah, absolutely. And there's never, I mean, I think the challenge, we're sitting in November, coming into the end of the year. And so I think for a lot of folks, a lot of folks coming to the end of the year, coming into a new year, will do, you know, New Year's resolutions. Many of them, not all of them, but a lot of them have to do with health and trying to be healthy and live better. And, you know, what is more fundamental to living well and being well and living a healthy life than breathing properly? And the answer is there is nothing. There's nothing, nothing, nothing. And so I challenge anybody out there, and it doesn't mean that these other things aren't important, because they are important. And doesn't mean that, you know, sort of, you know, exercise and diet and the things that people typically put on their checklist of, yeah, I'm going to go to the gym, I'm going to start eating, you know, a balanced diet, I'm going to do these things. And those are great. And that's a good thing that you want to do those things. But again, I'd sort of say, you know, when you're thinking about that New Year's sort of, or the new year and your sort of wish list, if there's a question mark on your breathing, I'd put that first. Because you can't do anything else unless that's working properly. And the other reality with kind of how we approach things is that, you know, this is a weird dynamic. We're talking about sort of a fundamentally life-impacting issue, and to solve that oftentimes is a simple 10 to 15-minute office-based procedure. Mm-hmm. It's almost unfair that that dynamic is that stark, where you've got this massive issue and we could do something relatively simple to correct this massive issue, and therefore, you know, it's something we want to let people know that it's worth seeking attention out for. And, you know, on the flip side, it's as gratifying as you get is seeing somebody who's been suffering their whole life or for a long time and take the suffer away. Take that, you know, take the boot off of their neck is what I often say, which is kind of it's a harsh analogy, but it's true. If all of a sudden, if your whole life, you've been living your life with somebody with their boot sitting on your neck, mm-hmm. and you can't breathe, and you don't know that somebody's, you just think, okay, that's just normal. And all of a sudden somebody comes by and lifts that off of your neck, you're thankful and you're appreciative, and that's a good thing.
That's
and
a
so
good
if
thing.
We're going to lift let's lift those boots off of people's necks and let them breathe properly.
You're right.
And that's, like, it's the way it ought to be, and unfortunately for a lot of folks, it's just they don't know they've got a problem.
Right, and I think Advent's, you know, our mission, you know, our charge has been to, you know, make a huge impact in patients' lives in the least invasive way possible. And I mm-hmm. think that, you know, that's what we've recognized as our focus moving forward, and, you know, driving that every day.